Minister Lawrence Wong, Excellencies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the final session of the conference. I'm sure you'll all agree that we've had a very rich and productive day. We had the breakout sessions. We heard from Minister George Yeo. We thought he's going to speak about the future of Singapore, but he spoke about the future of the world. And did mention Singapore here and there. Then, of course, we just had a great panel with Roger Cohen and Joe Studwell also. Now, before I introduce our guest of honor, since it's our 10th anniversary, it's only appropriate that I share some good news with you. You know, I mentioned in my remarks earlier in the day that the Lee Kuan Yew School of Public Policy is the third best endowed school of public policy in the world. Its endowment has just gone up a little bit. I'm pleased to inform you that Mr. Stephen Driadi has agreed to donate $1 million to the school. We are grateful to him. $500,000 will be used for a project which we have called the Future Proofing Project for Singapore, and $500,000 will go to the Asia Competitiveness Institute. And of course, we're very, very grateful to Mr. Stephen Driadi for this generous donation. But we also make it a point not just to announce the $1 million donations, but also the small donations. Here, I'm pleased to inform you that one of our former colleagues, Mr. Stavros Yanuka, who was Executive Vice Dean, had earlier donated $80,000 to the Mystery Yanuka Development Fund, and he's just topped it up with another $20,000, and that'll be used for staff development. I'm really glad you're clapping, because the reason why I'm making this announcement is to give you a hint. If you want to contribute, we are ready and willing to accept your contributions. I also want to share with you another piece of good news that, and we only heard the news today, by the way. One of our colleagues, who's both with the Lee Kuan Yew School and the Yale NUS College, Associate Professor Rahul Sagar, and you'll see him on stage in a few minutes when we launch the two books, has won the 2014 Louis Brownlow Book Award for his book Secrets and Leaks. And this is the most prestigious book award in the field of public administration, awarded by the U.S. National Academy of Public Administration. So a special round of applause for Rahul. Rahul, you can stand up and take a bow. Peace. Now, after all that good news, it now gives me real great pleasure to introduce Mr. Lawrence Wong, who's also a dear personal friend and a friend of the school. He's now the Minister for Culture, Community and Youth and the second Minister for Communications and Information. He joined politics in the 2011 general election, where he was elected as MP in the West Coast Group representation constituency. Before he joined politics, Mr. Wong was a civil servant, and I had the great pleasure of working with Minister Wong then. He was very highly regarded by his peers and colleagues, not just for his practical intelligence and his commitment to public service, but also for his humanity and his humility. And while he was still in the civil service, Minister Wong and a few friends founded a youth mentoring initiative called Promise Works to help neighborhood school kids achieve their potential. He began his career as an economist in the Ministry of Trade Industry, and then joined the Singapore Admin Service while he was overseeing budget policy at the Ministry of Finance. He then headed the Healthcare Finance Division at the Ministry of Health before becoming the Principal Private Secretary to the Prime Minister from 2005 to 2008. And between 2008 and 2011, he was the Chief Executive of the Energy Market Authority, where he led efforts to enhance competition in the industry and to create more sustainable energy options for Singapore. And as you know, Singapore imports all its energy, and its success in handling the energy challenges is in no small part a result of the efforts that Minister Wong made in the Energy Market Authority. My colleague, Donald Low, who, by the way, has been in many ways greatly responsible for the 10th anniversary celebrations today, was once quoted in the Straits Times as saying that, and I quote, "Mr. Wong has always been public service oriented. He's patient, listens hard, and connects well with people. He's also intellectually honest and welcomes vigorous debate. So you can ask him difficult questions. I'm also pleased to inform you, this is a real source of personal joy, that he was educated at Tanjung Katong Secondary School, which I know is a very good school because I studied there for 4 years too. As you know, it's not one of the elite schools, but you know, it has produced great people. let me add here that Minister Wong obtained his undergraduate and master's degrees in economics from the University of Wisconsin-Madison and the University of Michigan, Ann Arbor. He's also, like the Prime Minister, when I mentioned earlier in the day, a graduate of the Harvard Kennedy School, a graduate of a sister school of public policy, which is why it's very appropriate that we have him today as the guest of honor at our 10th anniversary celebrations. So with that, it gives me great pleasure to call Minister Wong to deliver his remarks. Thank you.
Professor Kishore Mahbubani, Dean of the LKY School of Public Policy, thank you very much for your generous introduction. Excellencies and distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, I'm very happy to be here at the launch of the Big Ideas of Lee Kuan Yew. I think it's an important contribution to the legacy that Mr. Lee has accumulated over a lifetime of singular commitment to Singapore. And I thank all those who have worked on the volume for the wealth of insight that it offers into our first Prime Minister and his ideas. I understand we are launching the book later. There's also a book on the 10th anniversary of the school, which shares the research journeys from several researchers in the school, and I thank all of them for putting this volume together as well. Now, I've not had the chance to work with Mr. Lee directly. I've worked in the civil service for 15 years before I entered politics. I never got the chance to work with him directly, but sort of by proxy, I suppose, I worked for several years as the principal private secretary to the current Prime Minister. And through this stint, I've come to appreciate more fully the tremendous challenges that Mr. Lee had to overcome as our founding Prime Minister. When you look at what he had done, one cannot help but be struck at the tremendous courage that Mr. Lee and his colleagues showed in the face of great adversity. The sheer audacity of what they did was really quite breathtaking. You know, from deciding it was possible to have a formidable military to defend Singapore, to cleaning up the Singapore River, to building and creating a garden city, from deciding to make Singapore self-sufficient in water, to deciding to take on the communists when they were just in their 30s at that time. Mr. Lee holds firm conviction, but he's also a pragmatist who sees the world as it is. He had big ideas, but he also knows how to adapt to realities. So as we move into our 50th anniversary of independence next year for Singapore, our Golden Jubilee, I think it's timely to look at some of his big ideas. One big idea is that small states are inherently vulnerable and require a strategy to survive. Mr. Lee himself reminded us, and I quote, "The small countries have little power to alter the region, let alone the world. A small country must seek a maximum number of friends while maintaining the freedom to be itself as a sovereign and independent nation." So in the era of the Cold War, Mr. Lee and his colleagues practiced this principle decisively in securing multilateral alliances, building ties with major powers, and countering the communist threat at home. And the struggle waged against the communists is an important reminder that there's no clean line dividing foreign and domestic order. And this remains the case today. The world is in flux, borders are more porous than ever, and events and conflicts far away can affect us. Take the situation in the Middle East and the expansion of the ISIL threat. Even if Singapore is not a direct target, our foreign interests may be targeted. And we know that a handful of Singaporeans have journeyed to Syria to join the conflict there. Now, closer to home, we are right in the heart of a rising Asia. We are witnessing a major shift in the global balance of power. It's happening right in our doorstep, and there are flashpoints around us, like in the South China Sea. So while these events may seem far away from the daily lives of Singaporeans, they can easily impact our society and our security. And as a small country, we must always stay vigilant, keep looking outwards, because the changes in the external environment can have a big impact on us. The second big idea is related to the first on principle of security, and that is success. Not just success in the short term, but sustained long-term success. And for a small city-state like Singapore, success is not just a good to have. Success is virtually an existential issue. Because the world is far more competitive today than before, the rate of change has accelerated vastly, and we need courage and fresh ideas to stay ahead of the curve. And this is why we are continually pushing for new things. We are consolidating our port activities at Tuas for greater efficiency, but it will also simultaneously free up prime land for major renovation, redevelopment. We are pursuing new strategies to make innovation, productivity, and skills the basis for our economic development going forward. And the point is that we have not reached the limits of potential for Singapore. And there's still much more to be done and new ground to conquer. So I hope our young thinkers and entrepreneurs, a young generation in Singapore, will be inspired to roll up our sleeves and tackle the challenges of our day with a forward-looking spirit. All this must be done with a view towards maintaining a fair and just society with equal opportunities for every Singaporean. Singapore was founded on democratic socialist ideals. And as Mr. Lee himself acknowledged in his very characteristically frank manner at a 1972 gathering of socialist parties in Asia, socialism is an elastic word. Mr. Lee was against welfareism as a blunt instrument of redistributing wealth, and rightly so. But he recognized, and indeed he passionately believed, in the necessity of a society in which, regardless of wealth and status, everyone has an equal opportunity to make the best of his potential. And in Singapore today, the government is increasing social transfers, we are spending more, we are strengthening our social safety nets. So it's no longer an issue of whether the government should or shouldn't spend more. We will be doing so. The real issue is how to best spend the revenue that we get from taxes in a fair and sustained manner. And in that sense, it's not so useful to think of government as a separate entity from the people with its own source of funding, like manna from heaven, which we sometimes tend to do. It's like anything that needs to be done, we say the government will do more. The government will spend. That's sometimes our thinking, but I think it's not such a useful way of thinking about this, because really government is about the things we decide to do together as a people. And through fiscal policy, we contribute money into a central pot that comes from taxes, and we spend that money to give expression to the shared values we wish to promote as a society. What are these values? Well, I believe we all embrace as Singaporeans the virtue of work and personal responsibility. We want a society that upholds the dignity of work and rewards fairly in accordance to one's contributions and effort. And so through thoughtful and well-designed government programs, we can breathe life to these aspirational values. As Mr. Lee once said, we are conscious that people can improve their lives only if our policies get them to try for themselves. And so that's something we must always preserve, this motivation to try for ourselves with the promise of a better life and with trust in a system that recognizes the necessity and the dignity of work and personal responsibility. This is the only sustainable and responsible way forward for Singapore. The third big idea I would suggest is the need for a harmonious society that functions in the best interest of all. Many countries aspire toward interracial and interfaith harmony. But in Singapore, this commitment to secular multiculturalism runs so deep that it forms a part of our core national identity. And that is something we owe to Mr. Lee. So we have always emphasized a common national identity within which there are protected havens for different groups to live and practice their own identities. And this rich diversity, coupled with strong social cohesion, is something very precious that we must always cherish. It will not take very much to tear apart the trust and the mutual respect that we have developed over the years. And the challenge has become greater for several reasons. The impact of globalization and technological innovation, which is putting tremendous strain in the workplace. The ease in which radical propaganda and inflammatory remarks can circulate online. And the need for us to socialize new residents and immigrants who have come to our shores. In fact, these challenges are not unique to Singapore. Countries around the world are confronting very similar issues. And this is at least partly why we see the rise of populist movements everywhere, tapping on widespread social discontent, as well as nationalist and xenophobic sentiments to mobilize people. As a result, politics in many mature first world democracies are now more fractured, more chaotic, and more unpredictable than they were just two or three decades ago. In some cases, it has even become dysfunctional. One recent Financial Times commentator talked about this, and I paraphrase what he said. A politician who cares about the poor and vulnerable will honor them with candor, with honesty. He will tell them about the challenges of globalization, automation, productivity, and what practical state intervention can or cannot achieve. But since all this is politically untenable, it's far easier to peddle snake oil to the vulnerable. And we are not immune from these pressures in Singapore. In our population debate, for example, we had a major debate quite recently. We had groups that called for zero foreign worker growth. It made for a good slogan, never mind the consequences it would have on the economy, on local businesses, and more importantly, on Singaporean jobs. But opposition for the sake of opposition will not promote or strengthen our democracy. Mr. Rajaratnam, one of our founding fathers, once said that it's easy to win attention by disagreeing with the government. If the government says white, and you write letters or articles in the newspapers advocating black, then your column will be read, and you will be hailed at the next cocktail reception as an original and bold thinker. This is many years ago. Perhaps it still rings true today. But how does this sort of discourse help us in solving the real and vital problems affecting our nation? So I think this goes beyond partisan politics. It's about the kind of democracy we want to be. And I hope we can be a democracy of integrity and a democracy of deeds, made up of an active citizenry who get involved in developing solutions for a better society. All of you here are men and women of our academic and intellectual community. So you play an important role in this effort. I appreciate your commentaries, including the ones where you disagree with the government. I'm sure for good reason and not just for the sake of opposition. And may I also strongly encourage you to present the full complexities and trade-offs of the challenges that lie ahead for Singapore. There are many difficult long-term policy issues that need to be thoroughly and objectively explored. For example, on population, on immigration, on the income gap, on social programs. These should be thoroughly explored, and we should look at them objectively. A detailed exposition of the policy options we need to address these issues may not get as much publicity as arguments made by professional oppositionists, but they will go much further in strengthening our democracy of deeds. Mr. Rajaratnam said in 1978, and indeed, sitting here in Singapore, we sometimes overlook how difficult it is to govern a country. And you look at the experience in America. It was not so long ago that I remember reading Mr. Francis Fukuyama, the American academic, proclaiming the triumph of Western liberal democracy and the end of history. Now I'm reading his latest book, lamenting the decay in these very same political systems. As he puts it, the system in America has become trapped by its own political institutions. Americans distrust the government, so they are unwilling to delegate to it the authority to make decisions. Instead, they put in checks and balances, and Congress imposes complex rules, rules that inadvertently undermine the effectiveness of the executive, so the government doesn't perform well naturally, and then that reinforces the lack of trust. So it becomes a vicious circle, and it's very hard to get out of this. Now, I say this not to run down the American system. I have great admiration for the American system. And of course, governance in America is at a completely different scale compared to Singapore. And despite its political challenges, America has many strengths, including its creative and entrepreneurial economy and its resilient society, and its soft power is admired around the world. The point is that the environment can change very quickly if we are not careful. Our context as a city-state is unique, and we have to find our own way forward. But it will be like pushing the boulder up the hill. We have gotten higher, and it's getting more difficult. So for us to keep going in our next phase, all Singaporeans must push onwards and uphill. The government will support, encourage, and perhaps lead the rally. But it comes down to whether Singaporeans believe that this nation is worth striving for. Each of us must recognize the value as well as the fragility of what our people have worked so hard to build. In his first National Day rally, Mr. Lee said, we must, and I quote, consolidate ourselves to survive, and most important of all, to find an enduring future for what we have built. This was in 1966. There was no National Day rally in 1965 because independence came so suddenly as a shock. So there was no rally then. The first rally was in 66. And nearly 50 years later, it remains a goal worth striving for, what Mr. Lee said, to find an enduring future for what we have built. So I hope as we reflect on Mr. Lee's big ideas today, we launch a book, as we mark our golden jubilee next year, we will continue to work together in achieving this shared goal with the same courage, conviction, and collective spirit of our pioneers. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much, Minister, for that opening remarks. I should mention that the last question that Giorgio was asked was about the next 50 years of Singapore.
Oh, wow.
And he gave a very optimistic answer, by the way. And one of the, well, as part of his answer, if I paraphrase it correctly, he said the region is rising, we can benefit from this, and if we can just get some, a few crumbs, Singapore will do very well. So I was noticed that his perception is that we can continue doing well. You mentioned, you used the Mr. Rajaratnam analogy of pushing the boulder uphill and getting harder and harder. Now, in the sense, looking ahead the next 10, 20 years, what's your sense? Is it going to get harder or easier for Singapore?
Well, I think it's a bit of both. That we have every reason to be optimistic. We are right in the middle of a rising Asia. Our economy has developed. There are many more opportunities for young people today in so many fields compared to, say, when I was growing up. So you can excel in arts, sports. It doesn't necessarily have to be in just in academic success. The definitions of success have broadened widely, and there are many more opportunities. But I think if you observe where Singapore society is heading, if you look around the world at the challenges we see, I think there's cause for us to not to be complacent, to recognize the dangers ahead, the challenges ahead, and those were some of the things that I thought I should highlight in my speech just now.
Mm-hmm. Great. So, we have a question of my colleague, Professor Pua Kai Hong.
Yeah, I teach health and social policy here. I know, Minister Wong, you practice what you preach. You have been involved in the voluntary sector, and you've been pushing for civil society, the role of civil society and PPPs. And in your previous reincarnation as Director of Finance in the Ministry of Health, you have been pushing for more enhanced MediShield to involve the private component. So in your view, earlier on you alluded to the fact that one of the contributions of Mr. Lee was this emphasis on personal responsibility. But our current policy seems to have shifted a little bit towards middle ground to talk about shared responsibility, that the role of the state, and the government, and the private sector, and civil society will have to come in, other than the emphasis on individual savings. And so now the increased taxation and the increased role of MediShield Life now for an aging population, which is also the challenge now for the next 50 years in the context of the rising markets, but in aging societies in East Asia, what would be your perspective about an aging society and the role of PPPs and civil society to provide this sort of a joint responsibility, a shared responsibility?
Thank you. Well, the fact that there's the need for both government and the community to do more does not detract from the fundamental emphasis that we do want a society that's built on, you know, people taking personal responsibility for themselves. And that's a fine balance that we must strike. The government has committed to do more. The community should also support, whether it's through civic groups, private sector, corporates, or even NGOs and voluntary welfare organizations doing more to help and support individuals. But in doing so, let's find the right balance so that we do not inadvertently undermine personal responsibility. So I think it's about finding that right balance. On PPPs and the role between state and private, perhaps I'll say a bit about, touch a bit on that. It's never such a simple binary choice. You know, we tend to look at it as it's either national systems or it's private sector. And both, you know, it's not just a matter of structure. It's not so simple. There's no silver bullet in terms of finding the right organizational structure that will solve the problem. We just have to understand the, you know, whichever the structure, there are certain consequences and that need to be managed. If something is done entirely by the government, there is a risk of inadvertently over-reliance on government. But there is also the tendency for public sector to not be so efficient. And this is true all over the world. It's true in Singapore. I don't know if you remember, I was in the Ministry of Finance then. Donald was then with me too. Then we had this big debate about the seven wonders of the world. Of Singapore, seven wonders of the world and the seven wonders in Singapore. And this was our former Speaker of Parliament making a point that we had such extravagant public spending and our buildings were lavish. And so as a good civil servant, I had to call for a meeting to all the building owners, sit them down in the Ministry of Finance and say, look, what were the norms that you used to build your buildings? You know, why didn't you have this sense of cost of capital? Why weren't you thinking hard enough about, you know, prudency and all these things? So there's that downside. The flip side of it, of course, if it's entirely private sector, you have similar consequences. Well, you address the efficiency issue, the private sector will have a very natural incentive to make the most of capital. Cost of capital is ingrained in them. There will be a motivation to be efficient, and that's good, but there is a tendency to be short-term and to neglect certain broader public objectives. So so recognizing that there are, you know, whatever choice you make in structure, there will be certain consequences, and there's usually not a, you know, simplistic just one structure. A lot of these are hybrid systems that combine both public and private incentive mechanisms. So the question is understanding the incentives and making sure that they are best aligned to the objectives that we want to achieve. And I think that's how we should go about doing it. Even in this new world where there may be more partners, more people coming together to find solutions.
Can I just quickly follow up on the seven wonders of the world? Because actually, in some ways, you know, ironically, you know, if you look at it, if you look at a building from purely short-term economic perspectives, you would not build the Taj Mahal. But if you look at the return on capital, the Taj Mahal obviously was an uneconomic proposition, yes. But it was built for sheer love. And it's this massive overspending as a result. Yes. And it's now been useful for several hundred years.
Yes, indeed.
So in that sense, maybe we should build more seven wonders of the world. Sorry, please identify yourself.
I'm Bilal Haider. I'm MPM student from Pakistan. I'm working as additional secretary in Ministry of Education back in my home country. I have a question related to social protection in Singapore. 50 years ago, when the script of success of Singapore was being written, dominantly steered by Mr. Lee Kuan Yew, Singapore preferred to align itself nearer to the liberal model of welfare regimes, which was at that time and even today headed by US, followed by UK and Australia and other countries. And it did not prefer to be closer to the other social welfare regime like Scandinavians and the familialistic regime like continental European. So my question is that after 20 years, when we look back, currently as the growing inequality and the rising voice of the low-income group, they are pushing the government to enhance their focus upon social protection and safety net, because traditionally Singapore is considered as a productivist and developmental state. It had a lesser focus upon social welfare. So what do you see, given the rising pressure within the government and from the opposition, seeing the inequality growing, do you still feel that government would stick to its earlier individualistic-based social protection, and government should assume a residual role, or you see government in the coming years as being in a steering role and to be nearer to the welfare regimes in coming days? Thank you.
Thank you. We have already shifted our position, so there is no question that we are sort of, you know, where we were, going to remain where we were in the past. But I would make one correction to your narrative, if you will, that from the start, it's not as though we blindly adopted a liberal free market model. As I said, the government was founded on democratic socialist ideals. That was very strong. But we also had no money at that time in Singapore, 1965. So even if you wanted to have extensive social programs, it was not possible. But where it counted, the government made sure that public programs were put in place. One good example is public housing. We could have gone for a privatized model of public housing at the start. Somebody like Milton Friedman would have recommended housing vouchers, for example. We didn't, because we wanted it to be public housing done, and perhaps not with the best of, so a public model means you have the downsides of what I just described earlier, right? May not have that same sense of cost drivers and efficiency, but we felt that there was greater priority to make sure that every Singaporean had a roof over their heads and had that assurance. So the public housing program has remained in the public sector and it has done well for us. That's one example. And you can find many other examples in our history where from the start, we didn't simply go with a liberal free market model. We identified where the crucial needs were. We made priorities because of the lack of resources at that time. And we applied the resources that we had to the areas where we felt were of greatest concern and of high priority for Singaporeans. That was the mindset. It was not a government that started saying, let's go for free markets. Not at all. It was along the way that we adapted, but particularly on the economic front, we eschewed the sort of protectionist import substitution models. We went for a more liberal free market model on the economic side. So that helped us to grow the economy. But on the social side, in fact, you had quite a bit of social schemes, protection programs for individuals. Not as extensive, I agree, as the Scandinavian countries or the European countries, if you will. But certainly they were there based on whatever resources we had. And progressively over time, as the government has, as with Singapore's success, with more resources in the government's budget, the extent of social programs have expanded. And it's not in recent years, too. If you look at how government social programs have increased, it has been progressive. It has been progressing over the years. Income inequality is not a new issue we face. Right? The income gap, I mean, the Gini coefficient in Singapore in 1980 was 0.44. This is not a new phenomenon that arose in the last 5 years. In 1980, our income inequality was 0.44 because we are a city state. Right? So, and indeed, we face the pressures of inequality, you know, even back then, but it particularly increased more so after 97, after the Asian financial crisis. I again distinctively remember that because that's when I started work as a civil servant. I was in MTI and we were doing all these studies to look at what the impact would be and the concerns over income gaps. So that already was something we were looking at in 1997, in the late 90s, progressively through the 2000 period. And if you look at how the programs have been put in place, they have progressively been introduced during this period. Our workfare, a negative income tax, more social protection for individuals, and then, you know, increase, enhance more and more. And recently, we have made GST vouchers permanent. So it's made our GST, our consumption tax, a more progressive consumption tax. So this is what we have been doing, not recently, but progressively over the years. And as I described, our model is now no longer, has never been, and will not be a model where it's solely one where the individual has to rely on himself. There's a lot of government intervention, but our objective is to have active government, and in a way, active government that supports personal responsibility. It sounds kind of paradoxical, but it's a question of then how do we design effective programs in government that would provide support for the state and at the same time, provide support for the individual and at the same time encourage him to take responsibility and activate and mobilize community groups to support individuals as well.
No, I must say that's a very good description of what the government actually does. But it does create in the minds of observers some confusion about ideologically where does Singapore stand in the spectrum. If you had to sort of, you know, if you were forced to cast a vote, would you say Singapore today is left of centre or right of centre?
We cover the whole spectrum.
I thought that's the answer I would take. Anthony. I also have a question after that. Go ahead, Anthony. There's a Chinese MPM students are watching in another room. I have a question from them
okay,
after this.
Sure. Yes.
Minister Wong, it's so nice to hear you with such refreshing and direct views. And when we mentioned about Sharipova, the tennis player, you reacted, you are a normal person.
Sure. We came from TK.
Tanjung Katong Secondary School.
No, I was in England recently. I was in the UK recently. And the newspaper's reports were that in the referendum, it was a touch and go. And so there was a lot of excitement, including the Prime Minister and ministers going to Scotland and all. And so when you get press and social media running that, who are you to go and see to get a reality check? So one way is to go to the betting shop. The betting shop shows 11 to 2. It means you put 11 quid there, you only get 2 quid back. So the betting shop were quite clear. The no votes will win. But the press and social media was so clear that it was touch and go. But the result was 55 no, 45 yes. Now we come back to Singapore and say, okay, if you want a reality check, what do you go and see? So we read Dean Kishore. He said, you must develop a robust civil society. Sometimes it takes a little while longer. So society needs to have some markers that if you want some reality check, there is some reliable source. If not, then social media and various other features can take over. And then it could complicate, it could clarify, but sometimes it really complicates it. And maybe CPF is one of those things. Mm. So the question is, how that sense of reliability and trust, those values become very important.
Well, thank you. I fully agree with you. I thought you were going to suggest that we should have our own prediction market. They are quite accurate. I used to follow Intrade and Iowa. Yeah. And on the American elections, they were very accurate.
So who's going to win this next election in Singapore?
Because we don't have an Intrade. but I fully agree that this thing about reality checks or how we can have a discourse that doesn't veer towards misperceptions, untruths, half-truths. It's very hard for this to be just done by the government alone. So I agree partly with, you said Kishore's suggestion was a more robust civil society, and I think that's part of the solution, that the government can take some steps, but the society today, I think, is much more complex than just thinking about government and people. And then government acting as the proverbial referee, that's sort of the paradigm we have. But it's a more complex society. There are different groups, and from time to time, you do see groups speaking out when they see that certain norms have been infringed upon or are unacceptable. You saw that when there was the kerfuffle in the Hong Lim recently, where the groups, many Singaporeans thought they crossed the line and they spoke out themselves without being prompted. You see that sometimes when nowadays when people write letters or, whether it's to the newspapers or in the internet and different groups replying. So recently I had one where the Singapore Art Museum was criticized heavily by a museum goer, and I saw it, I said, we should do something to reply to this particular post. And before I could do anything, or our chaps could do anything, the next day, another group somebody else had written with a different point of view. And so I think these things do happen, are happening in our society, and we should encourage it. There will be a richer discourse, and hopefully through that, you can get more reality checks. But it's not going to be so simple. It's difficult. It's challenging. The medium of the internet itself doesn't lend itself very easily to such forms of exchanges, because it's a medium that, with anonymity, lends itself more readily to negative comments. So that's a challenge we all understand. We are dealing with it. Governments around countries everywhere are grappling with ways to go about doing this. So from time to time, the government also needs to do something. And that's why recently we have tightened up in terms of our cyberbullying laws, anti-harassment laws for internet behavior. And some of these things need to be done.
You know, when you were speaking just now, Sheikh Alupna, who's a minister in the UAE government and a member of our governing board, said, the ministers in Singapore are very young.
I look young only.
So this is an appropriate question to ask you from our MPAM class. The question is, generally speaking, what kind of role should young people undertake in nation building?
Wow. What kind of role should young people take in nation building? Well, I think for Singapore in particular, I hope our young people see that, own the future of Singapore, have that sense of ownership that they are able to build a better Singapore. So that's, I think, an important mindset. Don't think that we've reached the pinnacle of our achievement. There's a lot more that we can do, and the young people must have that sense that they can do their part to do something even better or greater for Singapore. We have about four generations, right? We have the pioneer generation, which we recently recognize. The pioneer generation are in many ways those who grew up, well, those who grew up between before 1949. So they are the.
Can I show my pioneer card?
Ah, well, people like
above 65.
Our dean, above 65. Actually, it should be above 70. Yeah, right. That means, but we have been a bit more generous, so above 65. Then you have post-war generation, right? Post-war generation is your baby boomers. And then you have Gen X, which is people like myself, anyone who is born post-65, thereabouts. I mean, don't take these dates as rocket science. Huh? I mean, there's a lot of gray and overlap. Post-65 to about early 80s, and then you have Gen Y today, the millennial. And the interesting thing is, you know, every generation thinks they are better than the next, than the ones before, right? So when we were growing up, I remember when my generation was growing up, we would see articles that Gen X, they are the cynics, they have no sense of direction, they don't know what they are doing. And this is not, I mean, reports, articles, Time magazine, Newsweek wrote this of us. It was reflected in the social milieu of its in popular culture. The movies growing up in that time reflected that too, right? But I think we turned out quite all right.
some of us.
and then, of course, with the millennials, with the Gen Y, actually, you know, I have a lot of optimism about them because, you know, yeah, people talk about the new generation being a me generation and you know, the entitlement mentality and all that. But with the young people, when you talk to them, there's also a great deal of idealism and there's a great deal of a sense of wanting to do something more. They want to do well in their careers, but they also want to do good. So I am quite hopeful that we have young people who can take our country forward. So if you take the Chinese proverb, the Chinese saying is that wealth does not pass three generations, right? So we have gone from...
One generation earns it, one generation keeps it, the third generation loses it.
One generation keeps, second generation spends, third generation loses it. Well, we have gone from our pioneers, pioneer generation, to today's generation, and if you think about this, then the Gen Y will be the fourth generation. So it's, you know, remains to be seen what will happen to Singapore in the next 50 years. But like I said, if our young people have that sense of stewardship, have that sense of ownership about Singapore, then I think we should be able to have a good future ahead of us.
Good. Yeah. Question from there, please. Yeah.
Hi. My name is Johannes Loh. I work for Black Box Research, a public policy market research agency. And I'm also a former alumni from LKY School. So I attended a talk by Kishore in the American Chamber of Commerce 2 days ago, and where he called Singapore, or he called Singapore to have the potential to be the cultural and the economic capital of Asia in the next 50 years. And you hear a lot of actually positive and optimistic voices around Singapore's potential. And if you look at the last 5 years, obviously there's a lot going on in the city. And there's this aspiration that Singapore needs to be a very livable city. And I would just like to add one adjective, an affordable city, because I think increasingly this is one issue that Singaporeans and young foreigners like me are feeling the pinch. And we are wondering, where's this trend going? So maybe can you give your perspective on that?
Sure. Well, it's an issue which in fact has, you know, this issue of cost of living, it's not a new issue. You know, every... government, every term of government in our history has been grappling with this. It's not as though our headline inflation rates are very high, you know, or nor our core inflation rates. So I don't know if you track our inflation. I've been starting to do this very regularly now that I sit on the MAS board. But our headline rates are not high. Our, you know, 2+%, our core inflation rate keeping at 2%. So our sort of inflation figures are in check. There are some areas where the costs are escalating, and it's partly due to several reasons. Some of it is because we import everything we have in Singapore. We import everything we consume. So some of these increases are cyclical spikes for food, for energy. It's this is our karma. We don't have anything that we own, so we import. And having a strong exchange rate helps to mitigate against that. But ultimately, if it's expensive, it will flow through to our costs. The other part of it that is happening now is a very difficult transition and restructuring that's happening. Because we are shifting gears in our economy, we are tightening up on the foreign workers, and then we are trying to uplift the wages of the lower income. And when you do that, it does translate to costs. So we just have to be mindful that it's both sides of the same coin, two sides of the same coin. On the one hand, these cost pressures that are coming are really, to some extent, a necessary part of our restructuring process, right? To raise the wages of our low-income workers and to provide that spur for restructuring, which is happening. And then there will be some consolidation in the industries, in industries which are not slower in productivity, and then the resources will be shifted to the more productive ones. So this is a transition that's happening in our economy now. It's a difficult transition, and hopefully we can go through this and come out, you know, more productive, managing the cost pressures as much as we can. We are keeping an eye on costs to make sure we are competitive and affordable. And for Singaporeans, we will continue to help them with other schemes because we can always provide ways to help our Singaporeans living in Singapore. So we'll do that, but it's a broader perspective of what's happening that we do need to go through this phase to restructure our economy and emerge hopefully stronger from it.
One of our speakers, Joe Studwell, has a question.
I just want to stay on this, Lawrence. So I was really interested about, you know, you said about having to call the real estate guys in and ask them about why the market behaves in the way that it does in this town. Now, I don't know who you called in, Ong Teng Fong or Kwek Leng Beng or whoever. What I imagine they said to you is, now, Lawrence, listen, real estate in this town is an oligopoly with strong cartel-like characteristics. And so we can get away with a bunch of stuff that you wouldn't expect from your economics textbooks. Now, would you like a cigar? Is that, in fact, what they said?
Well, I have not met with them myself, so I wouldn't be able to say. But I think if you talk to any property developer now, I don't think they are very happy with the measures that the MAS has put in place. So I don't think if they are sharing cigars, that's working.
Okay, any one last question before we go to the second part of the show? We're going to have a book launch, and then, as you know, since we are known as the Lee Kuan Yew School of Free Food, we have another reception. We have a third reception for the day. We have 3 points and three receptions. Any last minute questions? If not, can I just ask you the same question that, in a sense, we asked Giorgio at the very end. As you look ahead in the next 50 years, and as you talk to the young people in Singapore and try to tell them what is coming down the road, what are the two or three things you would highlight as sort of positive developments that might be coming down the road for Singapore that we can, in a sense, anticipate?
Hmm. Well, I would say that, first of all, for our young people, the opportunities truly are plentiful. I think there are many opportunities opening up in terms of within Singapore, in the region. The training, the education that we've provided them puts them in very good state to seize these opportunities. So while there are pressures out there, and I don't deny that they exist, whether it's affordability, cost of living, concerns about job security, I think we can remain optimistic that there's a good future ahead of us, including for our young people. So I would encourage them to seize the opportunities that they see, make full use of them, make full use of these opportunities, whether it's in Singapore or in the region. And when you look at where Singapore is headed, we do have plans to continue building this nation. We are not at our limits. There are plans, as was highlighted just now, not just on the economic side, in terms of our social development, building a stronger, more effective social safety net. We have plans to build a more livable city. We have plans to build a more sustainable city. We have plans to make Singapore a cultural city. So these are exciting plans for the next 50 years. But you know, the plans can only materialize if we all work together at it. And so there's a lot of potential for young people to come together, contribute ideas, and join in this effort to build a better Singapore in the next 50 years.
Well, I think you'll all agree that this optimistic note is a good one to end on, especially since Roger Cohen reminded us, he wrote a column recently called The Great Unraveling, which I read. And if you read The Great Unraveling, you do get a sense that the world might be coming to an end. So that, you know, you've had both a pessimistic point of view, and as we discussed earlier, as Giorgio was saying earlier today, we live in some ways in the better half of the world. So it's interesting to see that speakers from this side of the world have a very optimistic view of the world. And so it shows that when we talk about Singapore and the rising Asia, the theme of our conference, I guess the general conclusion is that we can afford to be optimistic about the future. So with that, please join me in thanking Minister Lawrence Wong coming and sharing his thoughts with us. Yeah.
On the count of three, I would like to invite our distinguished guests to unveil the books. One, two, three. I would now like to invite Professor Mahbubani to present Minister Wong with a token of our appreciation, please. We have now come to the end of today's event. On behalf of the Lee Kuan Yew School of Public Policy, I would like to express our sincere thanks for joining us in celebrating the school's 10th anniversary.